I think that might be my cue. Good morning, everyone. My name is Krista Harden, and I am the president and CEO of the U.S. Dairy Export Council in the United States. So very excited to be here to talk about climate smart and sustainable dairy production. We have a wonderful panel. Okay, wonderful. That would be great. We're excited to have this panel. I'm going to introduce them in just a few minutes. And the main thing, and I'll say to the panelists and really to the audience as well, this is, you know, there's a lot of talk going on here this week and next week, a lot of conversation, a lot of good meetings. But I would say for the U.S., for the global dairy industry, it's a time for action. So I encourage you to talk, be proactive, talk about what's really happening on the ground, talk about the commitments and how they're actually playing out on farms throughout the globe. I think we can really educate our audience here, and because this is recorded, we'll use this in many, many other venues to make sure that, a broader audience understands what's happening in dairy and our commitment to being a solution for the environment, not the problem that some like to label us. So before I go any further, I think we have someone, a special guest who would like to say hello to us. Would you like to, Mr. Director General?
Thank you very much, Krista. Good morning, everyone. Welcome once again to, the home of sustainable agriculture of the Americas. I recognize your friendship, this strategic alliance, and the fact that we share values. We strongly believe in, the role that our farmers are playing, the fact that science and innovation is key for having good policies. And once again, repeating always, agriculture is part of the solution, is not part of the problem. With this in mind, thank you once again. I'm sure we are going to enjoy this, session. Thank you. Oh yes, let me introduce the Minister of, Livestock, Agriculture and Fisheries of Uruguay, Fernando Matos. Fernando, would you please introduce yourself?
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here and to share about this those concepts in order to that's so really to put in road all the projects, and we have a lot of conversations about environment and production, and I think is a great idea and a great project here from ICA to be here and to put in discussion the importance of agriculture and food safety systems. No, so we are very glad to be here and to hear about you, your several comments in dairy sector. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We're honored to have you with us. And thank you, Director General. Without ICA, such a wonderful partner for all of us. So we're going to get started in just a minute. I'm going to introduce each panelist and give them a few minutes to talk about what's going on, who they represent, and give us some, good comments. I'll start with my friend Donald Moore, who probably does not need much of an introduction to this crowd, but I'll do it anyway to embarrass you. Donald is the executive director of the Global Dairy Platform based in the Chicago and in the U.S. He serves as chairman of the Dairy Sustainability Framework as well, and is a member of the guiding group of the UN Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock. I always wonder what GASL stood for, so I'm glad to see it, spelled out. He has a lot of other things on his bio that I won't read. He can weave them into the conversation if he likes, but we'd love to hear from Donald for a few minutes.
Well, thank you, Krista, and thank you to AICA for organizing this fantastic, pavilion. We need to work out how to stop the feedback here. But thank you, Manuela, for this organizing this, pavilion, and to US Dairy Export Council for the opportunity to speak this morning. As Krista said, I'm Donald Moore. I'm the executive director at the Global Dairy Platform. And one of the things that I'd like to talk to you about today is the work that's been going on within the dairy sector globally to promote and support dairy farming around the world to become more sustainable. About 9-10 years ago now, the Global Dairy Platform, in conjunction with the International Dairy Federation, my friend Caroline here from IDF, during the IDF World Dairy Summit in Yokohama, Japan, we launched a program called the Dairy Sustainability Framework. So for the last 10 years, we have measured and monitored and tracked sustainability performance across the global dairy sector. And we can tell you now that the single most important, the single highest priority item across this, which measures social, economic, and environmental outcomes, the single highest prioritized item across the global dairy world has been greenhouse gas emission reduction. As a result of that, in 2019, working with the UN Food and Agricultural Organization, we conducted a study, a global study, into what was the global dairy sector's impact on climate change. And that study tracked over a 10-year period from 2005 to 2015 and demonstrated that in that 10-year time period, the emissions from the dairy sector, the emission intensity from dairy around the world reduced by 11%. In other words, a kilogram of milk was producing 11% less greenhouse gas over that 10-year period. However, absolute production of dairy had gone up by 30% in that 10 years. So the absolute emissions had also increased. It increased by around 18%. And the FAO commented that if we weren't making the progress we had been making in the dairy sector, absolute emissions would have gone up by 38%. So good news on one hand, intensity coming down. Bad news, effectively, that absolute emissions continued to increase. Following that report, the board of the organization I run, which represents major dairy companies from all over the world, we've got the CEOs of 8 large dairy companies from the United States, from Canada, from Europe, from Japan, from China, they said we need a program in the dairy sector to tackle absolute emissions. And so early last year, in conjunction with IDF and 5 other organizations, we launched a program called Pathways to Dairy Net Zero, recognizing that 80% of the emissions from the dairy sector come from emerging markets, 20% from developed markets. And in those developed markets, many of the big dairy companies have committed themselves to science-based targets already. They've put in place specific targets and reductions in scope 1, 2, and 3. Scope 3 in the dairy industry, obviously, being typically the farms. And that's where a large element of the challenge comes from. But then in the emerging dairy economies, where 80% of the emissions are coming from, that's really where we see a challenge for the dairy sector. How do we help those emerging economies to tackle emissions reductions at scale? We're working very closely as part of the Pathways to Dairy Net Zero initiative with the International Fund for Agricultural Development, with the Food and Agricultural Organization of the UN, and with the Green Climate Fund to obtain the funding necessary for transformation in those markets. We've approached 10 countries, and out of those 10 countries, 9 of them have already signed on to this program. In the Americas, I'm delighted to say that it's Uruguay, Costa Rica, and Colombia who've signed on to the program. In East Africa, we're working with Tanzania, Kenya, Rwanda, and Uganda. And then in Asia, we're working with Pakistan and Vietnam, and still in discussions with India. But those 10 countries between them represent more than 30% of all the emissions from the global dairy sector. We've started with the first regional concept, which is for East Africa. And we're at the point where we've got a submission into the Green Climate Fund for what they call project preparation funding, which will give us the money to develop the full-blown proposals for each of those 4 countries. And I was just talking to Minister Matos this morning. The FAO is planning the first conversation in the Americas for early December this year, where we'll start to the work on developing that proposal for the Americas as well. And I think I'll probably talk too long, Krista. I'll leave it there and let you introduce your next speaker.
That sounds great, Donald. Thank you. We'll look forward to getting into more discussion with you. It's a pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Caroline Edmond, is the Director General of the International Dairy Federation, IDF. It provides the world's leading source of expertise and scientific knowledge for the dairy sector. We appreciate your leadership. And I know you live in Brussels now, but you're a very proud Canadian. And That's we're very happy to have, at least for me, a neighbor to the north here. And you have quite a lot of pedigree in Canada as well, serving as the executive director of the Dairy Farmers of Canada and a representative of the government in Quebec. So thank you very much, Caroline, for being here. I look forward to your remarks.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the invitation. And I will have a couple of slides because I love to have some visual so that it attracts attention. You can look at that instead of looking at me. Actually, it is a pleasure to be here and very exciting to be talking about sustainability. And I'm going to take a bit of a step back just to have a bit of a broader view as a global dairy sector of what we've been doing. So it is clear that dairy is crucial for sustainable food system, but as well a healthy diet. But how do we do that? And I think it's important to talk about commitment in action. And I'm going to give you a bit of example of what we've been doing as an IDF Federation. So maybe the next slide, please. So as mentioned, Krista, our role is really to help develop standard. We actually help sharing knowledge. We help building methodology. And we help working together and connecting people so that we can share that science and for our decision maker, for government, and for policymaker. It is very important that we all work together to make that work happen. And in order to do that, then we welcome experts from around the world to join that work with us. For the time being, we have actually a pool of 1,200 experts that is actually coming from farming, processing, academic research, and so all aspects of the dairy sector. That's the strength of the organization, is to have all that expertise together so we can help the sector to move forward. On the next slide, the global dairy sector, as we've said earlier, has made commitment. And one of this first commitment is the Dairy Declaration of Rotterdam that was signed by IDF and FAO in 2016 to showcase the importance of the commitment of the sector to the sustainable development goals, to development, but also to measurement and reporting. So this is the basis of our commitment as a global dairy sector. Next slide, please. And as we just discussed, the pathways to dairy net zero is actually anchored into that commitment that we had as a global dairy sector. So we're not only just committed to sustainable development goals, but we're also committed to climate action. And this is very important that we have that in mind because it's all that work together that is making that impact. Next slide, please. It is important to showcase what we do. And we've been saying, you've talked about action, Krista. We've been publishing since 2018 what we call the Dairy Sustainability Outlooks, where we share commitment, project, program, research around the world in a dairy sector. That provides example, and we do have a special edition for the COP27 on climate. But this is our way of giving example. You know, you have the quality and you have the quantity, and with DSF, we have indicators. And with the outlook, you have examples. And those goes end to end so that we have a story that is clear, because those stories are inspiring. When you see the commitment in Australia and you see commitment in Canada and US and in Zimbabwe, you know you want to do your part as well. So those are part of the work that we do. The next one, please. And this is just to give you an idea. But IDF is there to provide the methodology, the standard, the science behind it. So we do all of those publications. And recently at our IDF World Dairy Summit in Delhi, we actually launched two very important publications. One was the revised LCA methodology for calculation of green gas emission. It's a third edition, very important. It was launched in September. And we also had a methodology for carbon sequestration, another piece of work that has been going on as a collaboration for many years. So those are two examples, but we do have publication on water, on biodiversity, on eco-friendly energy resource, and all of that is helping the sector to align, to harmonize, and to be able to share that story. If you are interested to find any of those, they are on our website. I do have QR if you want to have a direct access, but this is just example of what we can do to support the sector moving forward. Next slide, please. I just wanted to take a minute to talk about the importance of nutrition, because we're here to talk about climate and we talk about sustainability and we talk about environment, but we need to compare comparables. And you know what? If you don't take into account the nutrition dense element of dairy, then we end up in a situation where people can claim that they believe they have a lesser footprint. But the reality is that the nutrition value is key and cannot be left aside. So that's why we are doing some work in IDF in trying to identify what could be those indicators for nutrition that should be taken into consideration. And FAO as well has been working on that. So we are collaborating. But that aspect of nutrition is key and needs to be part of the story. And then last slide is just wanted to mention to you, there's all kinds of things that we do to inspire and encourage innovation. And the latest one we had is IDF Dairy Innovation Awards, where we actually had a special category for sustainable farming, one subcategory for environment, as well as a climate action category. And the winner of the category on sustainable farming from environment was the National Dairy Development Board from India, a woman cooperative using biodigester to make manure. And it was just beautiful to see their reaction in winning that international award. It's a recognition and it's inspiration. So that's what we do. And I really encourage you to participate, encourage your country to participate. We'll be giving the award in the summit in Chicago next year. And I do believe that's my last slide. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. And thank you for the plug for the next meeting, which will be in Chicago. We're very excited in the U.S. to host. It's a wonderful meeting and a convening of a lot of ideas and challenges, and also identifying opportunities for the global dairy sector. Thank you very much. The next person, I don't even have to read my notes to introduce Marilyn Archie. Not only a great friend, but she is the chairperson of Dairy Management Inc., which is the largest dairy farmer organization in the U.S., represents 30,000 or so dairy farmers across the United States and all 50 states. So thank you, Marilyn. She's also a dairy farmer. I've been to her farm. It is just lovely. She farms in a very intense, vulnerable area, I think, Marilyn. I'd say, you know, you're right there on the Chesapeake Bay, a very key area for the U.S., a lot of urban encroachment there. You have a lot of close neighbors in your area. So you live this every day and have to be a good neighbor as well as a good steward. And you certainly are, you and your family. So welcome, Marilyn.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. First of all, I want to introduce our farm. My husband, Dwayne, and I have been farming for quite a few years. We're celebrating our 38th anniversary today. separately, but he's such a good guy. But yeah, Dwayne and I have been farming there with his parents, and his parents have now retired, but yes, we're 40 minutes north of the Chesapeake Bay. And, you know, when I think of sustainability, I realize, and I look back at my father making decisions on his farm to contour his fields, you know, to make decisions that improve the soil health, that you know, improve the water quality, because the Chesapeake Bay was, you know, very front and center for our farm. And that is not unique to the country. You know, there are watersheds across the United States that require, you know, different regulations for different reasons. So it's not all the same. The watersheds are all different. But for us, it was because of the rolling hills, it was soil quality and the runoff. But Dwayne and I have about 800 cows in a very tight area, as you mentioned, with we're an hour west of Philadelphia, so a lot of close neighbors. And that caused us to look at our system and try to decide, you know, what can we do to improve the environment? What can we do to improve our farm? And improve relations with our neighbors. And so in 2017, we put in a methane digester, and it will capture the methane from the manure from the cows, and convert it to electricity. So we have enough electricity to run the farm. We also are able to put quite a bit of electricity back on the grid to help run our neighbors' houses and operations. We also can take in some food waste and we'll do that. We bring in, leftover food from, Wegmans, which is a grocery store nearby. Also we'll, you know, various types of food waste. And I will say that's a part of the farm that Dwayne and I look at each year and try to decide, you know, how can we improve? How can we add to this? And so right now we're looking at a depackager, which will take, food that is, you know, to be put into a landfill, depackage it, The food from the package goes to the digester. The package will obviously go to the to a recycle. And so it takes that out of a landfill possibility. So it's it is a nice way to recycle. Another recycling element is there's the nutrients, the liquid coming out of the digester goes back on the fields for our fertilizer needs, for our nutrient needs to keep the soil healthy. And also there's a byproduct that comes out of that we can recycle back in the barn, and it's used for the bedding for the cows where the cows lay. So it really is a circular operation. And, you know, really, if I can just have a minute or two to talk briefly about it, it goes in line with what we have done in the U.S. Dairy industry. In 2020, we committed, the entire industry committed to being carbon neutral by 2050. And, you know, at the time, bold goals for the U.S. dairy industry, but also knowing that it is, it's going to take a lot of different tools to be able to get there. One of those is technology. A digester is one of those tools. It's not something that's going to work on every farm, but it is something that will work on some farms. And so every farm can do something, but not every farm would do the same thing. We have a very diverse industry in the United States. Our diversity, I believe, is our strength, but it also offers a lot of opportunities. So committing a lot to across the entire industry, looking at farms, small farms, medium-sized, large farms, and how can we provide tools back to the farmers to be able to reach that goal of carbon neutrality.
That's great, Marilyn. Thank you so much for all those details about your family farm. And I'm sure we'll unpack even more what's happening in the U.S. and the commitment to those goals. So thank you very much. We're going to shift gears just a little bit regionally. And also we're going to have some video contributions to another great partner who could not attend COP this year, but wanted to participate in this panel and provide some input through video. So the Pan American Dairy Federation of Propali has a nice couple of videos for us. We're going to see about the commitment for that region.
Determinar el balance de carbono en predios agrícolas y ganaderos, identificando medidas de mitigación que fortalezcan la generación de sistemas de producción carbono neutrales, fue el objetivo del proyecto de la Fundación para la Innovación Agraria, FIA, ejecutado por el Instituto de Investigaciones Agropecuarias, INIA, junto al Instituto Forestal. Las instituciones dependientes del Ministerio de Agricultura. Los resultados de estos estudios pioneros fueron dados a conocer en el seminario internacional Balance Carbono en Sistemas Agropecuarios del Sur de Chile, hacia la carbono neutralidad. Realizamos solo la región de los lagos y determinaron que, a pesar de las diferencias entre los distintos pueblos y explotaciones, en la zona sur hay predios agrícolas y ganaderos que ya son carbono neutrales.
En este seminario tan importante que está organizando el INIA, gracias a un proyecto Balance de Carbono, en el cual están desarrollando toda una guía metodológica para revisar cuáles son las emisiones de carbono en algunos rubros importantes, ya sea la leche, la carne, avellanos, cereales. Para nosotros es fundamental, como FIA, apoyar estas actividades, en especial cuando se trata también de trabajo coordinado. Estamos trabajando con el INIA, pero también con INFOR. Por lo tanto, acá hay un apoyo realmente importante hacia la comunidad en esta región de los lagos.
La iniciativa consideró una importante e inédita alianza estratégica público-privada con las principales asociaciones gremiales y corporaciones del sector agropecuario del sur de Chile, como Fedeleche, Fedecarbo, Consorcio Lechero, Corco Carne, Sojo y Avellanos Patagones.
Este proyecto, que ya lleva unos años y que estamos dando término hoy, nos ha permitido informar metodología para poder estimar el balance de carbono a nivel privado. Esto es un tremendo avance a nivel nacional y yo creo que a nivel internacional también, me dieron una mirada desde una mirada nacional, como diría lo teníamos en el inventario de gases de invernadero a una escala mundial, tomando en cuenta los principales hubos productivos de la zona sur del Chile, donde en este proyecto nos han acompañado las principales asociaciones gremiales y las corporaciones también, y han participado activamente en este proyecto, construyendo con sus productores para poder hacer estimaciones del balance que existe en los precios.
Este proyecto permitió identificar sistemas productivos agropecuarios representativos de la zona sur de Chile y determinar su balance de carbono anual. Además, también permitió analizar y comparar metodologías de cálculo de balance de carbono en predios agropecuarios, junto con proponer buenas prácticas y medidas de mitigación para optimizar la producción agropecuaria de carbono neutral y difundir los resultados del proyecto.
Estamos súper contentos y súper agradecidos de poder haber sido parte de este proyecto, de poder demostrar por números lo que nosotros pensábamos, que efectivamente nuestros sistemas productivos captan carbono. Eso se está demostrando y hoy día así lo estamos viendo con los resultados. Realmente estamos contentos, creemos que tenemos mucho por avanzar, mucho por seguir. Estos resultados van a ser sumamente importantes porque nos va a permitir avanzar en el camino hacia tener un programa de carbono neutralidad. Este proyecto y el próximo de primer línea que tiene que ver justamente avanzar hacia la carbono neutralidad en el sector del agro.
De esta manera, gracias al trabajo de científicos nacionales, se logró establecer que la producción alimentaria del sur de Chile avanza a paso firme hacia la carbono neutralidad.
Perfect setup for you, Cecilia. Not quite sure what happened with that video, but it's a great setup for you. And I apologize again for misuse of the mic and the speaker. I will learn by the end of the 90 minutes how to manage this, I'm sure, or hopefully so. I'm sorry for the background noise. It's noise is terrible. I'm honored to meet Cecilia Jones, an ag engineer, I believe, at the University of Uruguay. She's also working with the Ministry of Ag, Livestock, and Ministries and Fisheries, right? I'm excited about that. And has led the coordinated plan for climate change. So if I got some of that wrong, please correct me. But very happy to have you here and appreciate your participation in the panel.
Thank you, Krista. And I have to thank the Global Dairy Platform because they support us to make a trip to Sharm El Sheikh and be here and talk to you about some of the experience from Uruguay. So I'm gonna be talking from the public sector. So we had, farmer organizations, an actual farmer, and I would be somehow mentioning the role of public policies in all this. I think in our country, it's the same situation as in the global dairy, where it's very heterogeneous systems that have different challenges. And for each of those challenges, there's different solutions to walk that path of sustainability. From the Ministry of Agriculture of my country, Uruguay, we've been working on policies for sustainable agriculture production. And this is trying to combine the climate change challenges regarding vulnerability to climate change, taking all the efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but not losing sight of all those other environmental challenges that you mentioned also, water quality and how to recycle nutrients. What are the efforts that we need to make to keep biodiversity in the systems so that we can take advantage of all the ecosystem services that the pastures provide to us. So that's the place, that's the role of the public policies for the dairy sector. In my country, there's a National Institute for Dairy Production that This institute and the board sit all the industry, the farmers, academia, and the ministries also. And that's the place that articulates all these, the support for the dairy sector in our country. So when the Pathway to Dairy Net Zero first appeared, we jumped in the wagon. We were there saying, okay, this is interesting for us. And it's been some time now, and we're starting to focus on what is exactly that we need to do. Of course, as I said at the beginning, what we know now is that we don't know exactly what we need to do, because there's a number of solutions for the challenges that we have detected. We recently did a study of the environmental footprint of dairy and livestock production. And I want to underline that it was environmental. So we looked in water, soil, and air. We didn't just focus on greenhouse gas emissions, although that's what we're here for, but also on the other aspects of looking at how we can keep the environment for future production of food in our case. We have a national survey of dairy farms in our country that where we have modeled, we have characterized different production systems in the country. So there's very small dairy production systems that have production challenges where there's a technology available that needs to be applied to bridge the gaps or lift the barriers, you know, those, that kind of thing. And then we have other farms where there's more intensive production, where there's more inputs put into the farm, but they still have a ways to walk towards lower intensity of emission and more environmentally friendly practices. So we have a rainbow of things that we have identified at the farm level. But then there's the next level, and that's the integration with the industry. And there's opportunities there that we have identified also of integrated, for example, the case that you mentioned of getting a grocery from the grocery store to the farm. Conaprole, the video that we didn't see, and Tambo Sustentable, their initiatives, they're looking into ways of integrating what happens in the farm with what happens to the industry to lower the carbon footprint of those farms. So that's an introduction, and we'll keep talking, I'm sure.
Yes, that's fascinating. Thank you so much. You have a lot going on, I can tell, for sure. Well, we're going to transition now to more of a Q&A and hopefully discussion among our panelists. They're all experts in their areas, but they all work together in different ways. And I'd love to hear your different comments. So feel free to, you know, jump in on each other, correct each other, or add to the conversation, and encourage the audience as well. I'll be asking you for questions, but just listening to all of you talk, I have a couple of just questions to get things started. Donald, I'll start with you, wake you back up. Now that you're asleep, just teasing you. There are a lot of challenges in the dairy industry as we look going forward in climate change. Just wondering if you can think of just kind of one or two kind of main areas that we need to be focusing on if we're going to reach these goals that we're setting, we're going to be this environmental solution that we are talking about. Just what you're thinking about, what comes to top of mind that our industry should be focusing on.
Yeah, thank you. And just picking up on some of what Cecilia was talking about before, we need to acknowledge and recognize that there is not one dairy system in the world. There are many, many different dairy production systems around the world. In fact, according to the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization, there are 133 million dairy farms in the world. The average dairy farm has 3 cows. The farms in the world with more than 100 cows represent less than 0.3%. So 99.7% of the dairy farms in the world have less than 100 cows. So we need to, and one of the things we've been working on in the Pathways to Dairy Net Zero, in conjunction with the Global Research Alliance on Agricultural Greenhouse Gases and with FAO, is to come up with a way that we can define the different farming system topologies around the world. And we've come up with 6 basic topologies, from relatively low yielding, high emitting systems through to very high yield, high and low emissions And those different systems have got different profiles for the emissions within them. And we need to understand that, because if we don't understand the emission profile of different farming systems, we can't come up with the mitigation solutions to address them. And so on those very low yielding, high emitting systems, a lot of the interventions that we need to be helping farmers to make are about very basic things like feed practices, animal care and husbandry, and even the genetics in some parts of the herd. In parts of Africa, if I can talk about that for a moment, the average emissions from the dairy sector are somewhere in the 6 to 12 kilograms of CO2 per kilogram of milk produced. Then if you look at a very highly efficient industry like the United States, what we're talking about here, where their emissions are less than 1.5 kilograms per kilogram of milk produced. So what can we be doing to help different systems along the way come up with the interventions that will help them reduce their emissions? And I think, Krista, you said it in your opening remarks, it doesn't matter where you sit in the world, there are things we can do in the dairy sector to improve our environmental performance. And building on something Caroline was talking about earlier, we know all the good that dairy does in the world. We know what dairy does from a nutrition perspective. We know what that nutrition does for health. We know what dairy does for livelihoods. We know what it does for reducing poverty. We know what it does for impacting hunger around the world. We're about to launch a report with FAO on dairy and gender. So we know all the good that dairy does, but we also recognize that we, like every agricultural commodity, and I stress that, every agricultural commodity can do more to improve the natural environment, which we're working on. And I think this panel demonstrates today the commitment from the dairy sector to tackling some of those big challenges around emissions.
Well said, Donald. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. I want to shift just a little bit with Caroline, with you, and really building on something you were talking about in your presentation about the award winner, the women from India, which is great. It's wonderful. I was just looking at the numbers, and 37 million dairy farms are led by women globally, and 80 million women are employed in dairying. And I wonder if those numbers are even accurate. My guess is they're even a lot more. Can you talk about IDF's commitment to empowering women and getting involved in agriculture? Our panel shows that they're certainly involved at the highest levels, but what are the things that you're doing to also help them, not only empower them, but help them reach some of these goals as well in their operations?
Yes, definitely. Thank you, Krista. And indeed, when we talk about livelihood, it is clear, we always say there is the art of community, but there is also an engine of development. And we have a lot of example of that, but I can tell you that India is definitely one of them, where actually it has helped to transform the country and to help rise the economic of situation in India. One thing that also is important is, I would say, the role of dairy in women's nutrition. That's something we don't talk enough about. And IDF, we just created a task force for women in dairy. And it's one of the elements we've identified that we should actually try to promote more. Because at the end of the day, there are very specific things that dairy is doing for women's health at different stage in life that is very important that we talk about. And one thing I want to mention is the role of school meal program to keep girls in school. That is very important. Many countries around the world, actually, girls are going to school because they can get nutrition. Because at the end of the day, probably their parents wouldn't send them to school. So that's a very important role that dairy is playing. On the livelihood, and as I said, we had our first meeting last week of a task force on women in dairy, and our colleague from the National Dairy Development Board in India was mentioning for them, they saw the importance of increasing revenue for women is increasing the revenue and the livelihood of the family, of the community. It's sending children to school, it's investing in the house, it's investing in the business, buying another car, another buffalo. The trickle effect of the money going directly to women is actually making a very significant impact. So that's definitely something that we need to continue to work a bit more on. And as Donald mentioned, FAO is working on it. There's a lot of people working on it. But what we want to do in IDF as well is to connect women, to engage, but also to provide role models. Now we're lucky today. We know we've got this woman actually that is actually over gender balance, but it's not always the case. And then we see in role of governance in our organization and even in the dairy farming in general. often, you know, you'll farm as a family. And again, Marilyn is a good example. She's the one in governance and on stage. But in many countries, actually, that role goes to men again, even if the woman is as involved in the farming. So there's still a lot of work that can be done. And that is, I think, one of a very good benefit of the dairy sector that we should actually emphasize a little bit more.
Well, thank you. And thank you for allowing me a little bit of a moderator leeway here, because I'm so interested in women's role in agriculture and know IDF's leadership and your leadership personally in this area. And it goes also to the pillar you were talking about. One of the pillars of GDP and the economic sustainability as well, and livelihood. It all works together. Yes, you want to have a comment?
Something I probably should have mentioned earlier. There's a program we're working on with FAO and with the International Fund for Agricultural Development to develop a methodology to measure the socioeconomic impact. One of the biggest missing components in assessing the value of agriculture is understanding the value that it generates, not just economically, but socially as well. And there's a report that FAO is going to launch later this year, which looks at the socioeconomic impact that dairy has in 140 countries around the world, including issues such as gender. So that particular report will come out later this year, which I think will demonstrate from a nutritional perspective, nutritional access perspective, from a farmer livelihood, from even down to government income, what happens when you develop your dairy sector. And we think that's been a missing component in dairy development or in any agricultural development programs, being able to measure the socioeconomic impact.
Very good. It's a good reminder. Thank you. It's kind of a good segue, Marilyn, the question I really have for you and talking about the economic stability, the financial stability. So many farmers, you hear this more than I do, especially in the U.S., who say, I'm committed to being a good steward. It makes sense. I care about the environment. I want to be a part of the solution. But how can I do this financially? How can I still have to pay my bills, even though I want to do the right thing? It still has to make sense. In your mind, when you're trying to talk to farmers about why this makes business sense and how it can financially, you mentioned your digester and others, but there are other things that we can help farmers see that this is a good business decision as well, to be that good steward.
You know, it's interesting, because if you ask a farmer, if I ask my fellow farmers, what does sustainability mean? They will say sustainability means that I stay in business. Okay, that my farm is economically viable, that I can farm again next year, that I have something to transfer to the next generation, and that they can make a living at this. And we need that. We need that economic stability. All these technologies that we're looking at, whether it's technologies that we're testing on farm through the net zero initiative that we have, or whether it's simple best management practices, whether it's stream bank fencing, whether it's no-till, it's cover crops, they're feed additives, there are things, but they cost money. And farmers, at the end of the day, we have to decide, at the end of the year, we look at our bottom line and we have to decide, okay, do we buy feed or do we buy a new corn planter that does precision planting? And you're going to buy feed for the cows. Okay. It's we have to take care of the cows first. And so those technologies take a lot of funding. And I think really one thing we've realized in talking about climate change, talking about the issues we have, funding is a big issue. And I know the U.S. has really stepped up right now with the Climate Smart Grants to go toward technology. I know within the dairy management, within our checkoff, we have Nestle and Starbucks contributions to do some on-farm testing. And they're being tested on larger farms to see how they can be net zero. But then let's take that technology and scale it back, as we know technology can be, scale it back to work on all size farms. So I think, when we look at how fast technology has happened in the past 10 years and knowing it's going to happen even faster in the next five, I'm very hopeful that we'll get there. I'm very hopeful that we have technology coming down the pike that we have not even
I didn't do that.
We haven't even thought about yet. But it's just interesting. It'll be interesting to see where we end up. But we, okay, that's a different one. But we do need the funding to get us there, for sure.
Great, thank you, Marilyn. A lot said there. That was pretty cool.
A follow-up comment regarding
yes
this. It makes total sense what she's saying. You know, you need to, what when I make a decision, it's like, do I buy feed or do I buy some machinery that. And I think that that's where public policies play a big role of looking beyond the short term, looking long term, and providing tools for those decisions. And I want to mention an example we have in our country. It's we have incentives for investment in clean technology, adaptation to climate change, things that create more jobs, and that's something that provides support for these kind of long-term decisions. So how it works is that farmers apply for tax exemptions with a plan of investment plan. And there's an evaluation of these plans with where they're evaluated for use of clean technologies, that's solar panels, irrigation, et cetera. And there's points also for adaptation to climate change, things that would lower vulnerability to climate challenges. And also if you will create more jobs, that's things that also plays a high point in the evaluation of the project. And then the farmer will get a tax break that they can use over a period of 5, 3, 4, 10 years, depending on the kind of farm, the kind of investment. And what that allows is bring a buffer where you're waiting for that investment to give you some profit. Well, you have a tax break for that additional income that you want. But and that works, you know, farmers are very happy with the system. And one of the things that I should have mentioned before is that at least in my countries, farmers do not like to go to the bank to ask for a loan.
Yeah.
Because of these challenges that you mentioned, and this the investment, you have to make the investment, and that's not gonna change. But then you have that long term plan that will allow you to buffer that incertidumbre. I'm missing a word here. The one you don't know what's gonna happen.
Yeah,
the one word disappeared. So.
I think that's a great build on, and it really leads me kind of to my next question and talking about the role of the public sector. I've worked in government myself in the U.S. government. Sometimes you're a friend of the farmer. Sometimes they see you very skeptically and a little nervous about that relationship, worried about mandates and regulatory processes. How have you gone about in your country working with farmers to earn that trust, to earn that partnership for the public sector? You know, they are truly to help the farmers.
So do we have the trust? I'm sure this is like the dairy sector, not very homogeneous.
Yes. Right.
So the strategy is trying to make your policies go towards the same goal. Mm-hmm. So we have, for example, our national contributions to the Paris Agreement have goals that are for the agricultural sector. We have goals for specific sectors, forestry, natural grasslands. Mm-hmm. There's goals for dairy sector. So we have goals specifics for the sector that put the focus on things that are relevant for, in this case, the dairy sector. The other thing is, at least for anything that has to do with climate change and environment, the Ministry of Agriculture works very closely with the Ministry of Environment to put in place all those policies in a way that makes sense for food production. Uruguay is it's a country that what it does is produce food. What we do is export food. Milk is one, milk, cheese, butter. It's most of our production goes for export. So it's very important for us to provide good traceability of our products, good, you know, sanitary measures, and all the you know, labor laws and everything that that puts our product under good eyes. So so that's another thing that that the public sector is doing for the farmers, for the agriculture sector, you know, provide like a brand of products that you can trust and institutions that are safe and in a country that is democratic and there's human rights and we take care of the environment. So the, all those things in a country that what it does is export, I think we it's very important and provide a support to the farmers.
That's very good. Thank you very much for that. I like your answer. Anybody in the audience have a question? If not, I'm going to, I have one for all of the panelists. So be thinking, I'm going to call on you if you don't. But I do have one. Oh, you want to, Ryan? Please. Sure.
Thank you to all the panelists, Brian Lindsay from Global Dairy Platform. We're here at a climate conference, but we know that sustainability is really about the interaction between so many pillars of the sustainability spectrum. I just wondered whether the panelists might like to comment on the importance of collaboration, and Donald, you mentioned it in the Pathways Project, but how collaboration really does help us move forward at a faster rate.
I'll start. You know, collaboration in all of agriculture is so important for us. I also am chair of USFRA, which is US Farmers and Ranchers in Action. And that is an entity that can bring all of agriculture together. Okay. And so it's different checkoff boards that are part of it. It's different industry groups, but and that sitting around that boardroom has really shown me the importance of all of agriculture coming together, and you know, forestry, oceanographers, fisheries. It's not just about the crops and the livestock. It's all of agriculture, and it really is important. I think, you know, we have a strong message if we come together and talk about this as opposed to speaking in silos. So very important. Thank you, Brian.
Yeah, and thank you, Marilyn. And I would add as well, the learning from each other, because it's more than that. We've talked about the diversity of the system, but the diversity of realities geographically. And we learn a lot. It's by working together that we can learn that your situation is maybe not different than mine, but what your relationship with government actually, I'm kind of having something similar. So what can I learn from what you're doing? And I can actually try to adjust and implement in my situation. So it's collaboration, it's learning and sharing, and get inspiration, because that's how you progress. It's by being pushed a little bit, being actually a little bit of competition. You know, it's that that will actually make us better.
Just build on some of the, what's been commented on here. And I think one of the things we've got to do in agriculture is stop talking to ourselves, right? You know, here we are, we're as I look around the room, there's not too many people I recognize here who are not involved in agriculture in one way or another. And in the ag sector, we have a terrible habit of talking to ourselves about the benefits we provide. What we've got to do is start explaining to the rest of society the role that agriculture, in our case, dairy, provides. And, you know, we have to get outside our own comfort zone and talk to those people who maybe have alternate views. And one of the big challenges I think we face in the agriculture sector is agriculture really is under indexed in terms of the development funding that goes on in the world. I think, I can't remember the exact number, but something like 7% of all development funding in the world goes to agriculture. Within that 7%, livestock gets less than a third. So you think about it, you know, all the money that's been spent on development, one of the key fundamentals to life has got to be food. That's what agriculture's role is. We are not, as a society, investing enough in agriculture. So one of the things I would encourage all of us to do is consider, how do we collaborate with those outside our own sector? We're trying hard within the program that we're running across this panel on Pathways to Dairy Net Zero to interact with the UN agencies, with the Green Climate Fund, to bring funding to bear, tackling exactly the point that Marilyn and Cecilia made about bringing funding to farmers to help them make that transformation and that transition. The only way we're going to do that is by collaborating with others, by telling our story outside these sort of rooms with other groups.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Just on that, it's also, it's the same situation for research funding. there's a lot of disengagement from government and public forum on research. And that's also key, because at the end of the day, we do some kind of some research as well, but that it is important that we see more money coming into research.
Most definitely. Cecilia.
I just want to make a comment regarding this place where we're at. And at this moment, countries are discussing agriculture in the climate change convention. And countries are trying to keep the topic of agriculture within the discussion and in the agenda. So there's a long ways to walk, because we haven't convinced people that are in this event that agriculture is important and the place of role in climate, that adaptation to climate change is key for a number of people, basically to all the world, everybody that eats, it's has interest in this discussion, even though the countries are, you know, discussing this and trying to make an effort for agriculture to still be in the agenda. And the other thing is, we've heard a lot about implementation, you know, and I think this kind of initiatives in our country at least help us to work regionally with, you know, get together as countries with challenges that at least speak the same language, even though they're different, and move forward towards things that are meaningful and have results.
Well said. Well said. Did you have another comment?
Can I just say something? Please. You know, we have challenges as agriculture, but we also have solutions. And I think those solutions, we have to talk about those solutions. And I think if we come together, not just as dairy, but all of ag with our solutions, the opportunity is tremendous to impact the climate in a positive.
And feed the world.
And by the way.
Sounds like a song we're going to start singing. The other thing I wanted to make a comment on, just building on what Cecilia was saying, we have to be really careful that as individual countries, we don't try and solve climate change within the boundaries of our own country. We're seeing it happen in Europe at the moment with some countries that are trying to solve the challenge of climate change within their national boundaries. They are not considering, though, the impact that reducing production might have on nutritional security in other parts of the world, or indeed the knock-on effect. If they produce less dairy in a particular country, what happens? The country that's importing that dairy is not going to stop consuming it. What then happens to the absolute mass balance of greenhouse gases when you start producing milk in countries that are less well suited to it? So one of the messages I would love us all to take from today into all the discussions that are happening here is we have to think about climate as a global mass balance issue, not as an individual national issue. And the same goes for nutrition. You cannot make nutritional decisions within one national context. You've got to think about the impacts. The world is so interconnected. You heard Cecilia talking about how much dairy is exported from Uruguay. We are all dependent upon each other for our food system now. It is too interconnected. We need to think about that at a global level as well.
Well said. This is a great discussion. And I wish, and I know we're videoing this, is to be able to share this to a broader audience. You made the comment, a lot of folks in this room are friendly. They believe in what we're talking about, that what drew them to this agenda. We also need to be talking to consumers. We do a lot of, again, talking to each other. Any ideas from any panelists on how do we break through all the noise, all the information? The hum of this building is just an example of so many conversations, so many microphones, so many agendas. How do we break through and get to a younger audience, an audience who may not understand agriculture, an urban audience that's not connected to where their food comes from? Any ideas on what we should be, can be doing as an industry? Marilyn?
One thing the U.S. dairy industry is doing is looking at that younger generation. What do they like to do? And in the United States, gaming is a big deal. And so there's a young man who is a professional gamer, and his name is Mr. Beast, and he has over 100 million followers. And we have we have partnered with him for him to tell the sustainability story inside of his games. And so he will have games and be farming in those games. And as he's gaming, you know, other people are watching. I didn't realize there's a very high percentage of people, young people, who will game, but they'll also sit there and watch other people game. Okay. You know, rather than watching television, that's what they're doing. They're watching gaming. It's a huge thing in the United States. So that's one way we have tried to break through, is you almost have to meet that generation where they are. And it means doing things that I'm not comfortable with. Okay, I'm not comfortable with gaming. I'm not necessarily comfortable in sitting in a room with people who disagree with me, but that's what needs to happen. It's hard, it's difficult, but you know, we do have to stop preaching to ourselves, which we're very good at, but that's not always comfortable.
That's great, Marilyn. So Mr. Beast, Mr. Beast, you heard it here. That's what you need to be listening to and following.
Actually, I will go with the opposite of Marilyn and leave the modern world to go back to things that have been working. And actually, it is the importance of cultural diet. No, try not to harmonize diets around the world, but the reality is that there is part of diets and in many, many countries. And if you respect that, it's going to continue because it's part of the culture. When we were kids, we were eating that, and it's part of, and the other one is school milk program. Again, that's another one. That's where you get your school education on nutrition, on what's good for you. So school meal program have been working for 100 years around the world. So, you know, we know that works, and we do have an IDF knowledge of on school milk on our website. But I would say that what we need to do now is the increasing, the governments are moving from specific product, specific program to school meals programs, a more general program. So we need to ensure that dairy milk, dairy food are still included in those, because school meal programs have been working very well. But we need to make sure that by moving to more broader program, like milk doesn't disappear. And that's our next challenge. And we need to make sure that milk is still recognized as key for those programs in school, whatever name you give them, whatever is school, milk feeding, that doesn't matter, it's not important, but making sure that that is part of nutrition of children at school, because we have evidence on the health benefit, the development, the cognitive development for children, that has all been proven. So, you know, we need to build on that and making sure that dairy, milk, yogurt stays in schools. That's, I would say, with gaming, which is super important. But I think the old things are also working, and we should make sure that we continue doing that.
Great, great ideas. Yeah. Donald?
I was just going to say, the first morning that I came here to COP27 this year, there was a number of protesters outside. And there was one of them was holding up a banner that said, the problem with climate change is livestock. It's not coal. It's not big industry. The number one problem is livestock. And Brian Lindsay was with me, and we went over and we started talking to them. And it was a group of vegan activists. And when you start saying, well, okay, how do you propose we feed the world? Because 2/3 of the world's agricultural land is permanent pasture or meadow or savanna. The way that land contributes to the food system is the grazing of livestock. So if you remove livestock from the equation, you're taking 2/3 of the world's agricultural land out of the production system. How do we feed the world? And they didn't have an answer to that. And I think, you know, the challenge we have is we are the status quo. And so often when you're the status quo, it's hard to get excitement about what you're doing. But I think just some relatively high level basic facts like that are the sort of things you could see. They start to question, well, how are we going to do it? And I don't think they have an answer to that yet. But those are the sort of challenges we need to face. And I think somebody may have mentioned, it might have been Marilyn on the panel, that, you know, when I was growing up, everybody knew a farmer. You know, I mean, I'm a little older than a lot of you in the room, but we all knew farmers. You know, we had them in our family. Nowadays, so many people are so removed from where their food comes from. We need to just constantly remind them of those challenges.
Very good. I would like to have seen that interaction with you and the protesters.
Most mornings.
Understood. Are there any questions or comments from the audience? Yes.
My name is Fabio Niespolo. I work for Emerging Ag. And my question is probably banal because we are in a conference for taking some decision on policies on climate change. And as you said, Cecilia, agriculture is one of the themes to be discussed. And it's super important that agriculture will stay on the discussion. So one might be, you represent different perspective, industry perspective from the dairy sector, farmer perspective, government perspective. So what might be an outcome that you might like come from this conversation? Something that would be useful for what you are doing in your different sector?
That's a hard question, huh? Well, the first, I would say, to keep the topic of agriculture within the convention, I think that would be very relevant. Besides having the topic of agriculture in the convention, and it has to do with what Donald wants to mention, it is to include on the vision, not just mitigation, but also adaptation. That would be another outcome that is very important. All the agricultural representatives in these negotiations are saying this, okay, we need to focus on adaptation and how much mitigation, how much room mitigation is within agriculture. That's something to discuss. So I would say those two things, they're very big, I know, but those two things would be very positive. And then we had yesterday, I think it was the finance day. I think that the other outcome is, so there's been lots of studies saying, you know, that there's a lot of talk, not enough walk, and the funds need to show up for adaptation to climate change, for loss and damage, and in that big bag for agriculture. Right now, for what I know from my colleagues, all the funds that would go to loss and damage will come from the adaptation bag. So we're splitting the same, you know, few pounds, millions, something. Yeah. And so financing for implementation, I think it's something that it would be good to have a signal for that. Especially coming from a country that represents 0.03 of the global emissions. We used to be 0.04. Now we're 0.03, but it's not just on us. It's that the whole world is increasing their emissions. So we represent less, and a combination of us being better, but the world being worse. So that's not next. But yeah, that would be.
For me, I would say get farmers more involved in the conversation. It was just a few years ago that I first went to Rome with Global Dairy Platform and Donald Moore, and my first experience in speaking there, you know, there weren't many farmers at the table, and I look around this event as well. Agriculture is a big deal. There's not many farmers. And so I think it's very important that we, if we're going to talk about agriculture, that farmers are there talking, they're at the table, able to talk about it as well, because we understand our practices.
And I would say science-based decision-making. I think that's definitely something we have to push every day. And we've seen it around, just walk around and see there's a lot of information there that are far from being very scientifically based. And this is the world we live in. You mentioned it earlier, Krista, we live in a world of opinions and fake information. But as actors of the sector and as government, we need to insist on having decisions that are based on science. That's very important. And the other element I would say is inclusiveness and recognition that we need everybody to reach the goal and stop that approach that we need to exclude people. That said that the world is better without livestock, this is not helping. We all need to work together, as I said earlier, to nourish the world, not just feed them and nourish them, give them the nutrient they need. And for that, we need everything. And as I need to remind you, a cow is a natural recycler. He's eating something you and I can eat to make a nutrient-dense product. There's nothing better than that. So don't ask us to do, this is what it is. So let's get everybody and say, okay, let's all be part of the solution and focus on what we can achieve. We have commitment, we have actions. The path is still long. Obviously, we won't achieve everything tomorrow morning, but we're on that path. So let's admit that and say, okay, we're all working towards that on a science-based approach. And I think we can actually really move forward.
So you asked about a policy position. I think as agriculture, it's time that we stepped up and had a louder voice. Agriculture and forestry are the only two sectors that are both sources of and sinks for emissions. We are in a unique position, and so we should exercise a little more authority because of that position and stress the role that agriculture plays. So many of these other industries are out there looking to buy credits to offset their emissions. And who do they think is going to provide those credits? They think agriculture, they think forestry. And so I think we're in a unique position, and we should start to exercise a little more push, if you like, on some of the models that are out there around carbon accounting and things like that, because you can't achieve the objectives of the Paris Agreement without agriculture. But we as agriculture are under threat by some of the accounting models that they're putting in place. And so I think it's time for us to become a little more directive. The other thing I would say is that as the private sector, we would like to move a little quicker. Not a little quicker, a heck of a lot quicker than some of the processes move here. But we also have to recognize that the UN is like water dripping on a rock. It's very slow, but eventually it gets through. And if we're not there at the early stage to redirect those drips, then we're going to suffer at the end of that from the outcome. So we need to be diligent. We need to contribute to the conversation, to the process, but we need to try and also encourage them to move a little quicker. We're not going to achieve 2030 outcomes if we're still having meetings like this in 2029.
Yeah, well said. And it leads me to my last question. And thank you for addressing that one. That was very informative. We're going to have a little reunion of this crowd in 5 years. We're going to be, you know, a different city. Maybe the room will look a little different, and, you know, I'll look a little older. I'll learn how to deal with the mic by then. What will we be talking about in 5 years at agriculture or dairy part of an environmental solution? Will we just be embracing and patting ourselves on the back because we got it done, like Donald says? Is it yes? Is it no? What will we be talking about?
We're probably going to be talking about the wheelchair access, I think, in 5 years' time. From our perspective, you know, the program that we're working on across the dairy sector on Pathways to Dairy Net Zero, it does trouble me the speed at which the UN funding operations move, which is about a 2-year cycle to get funding in place. That's got to move quicker. But in 5 years' time, I would like to think that those 10 countries that we have as the early adopters to Pathways to Dairy Net Zero, forgetting for a moment about the developed world that's moving very, very quickly, the US, Europe, Oceania, but in those emerging economies, those emerging dairy markets, I would like to think that we're at the point where we have, within 5 years, we have those programs starting to show real tangible results. We know from a pilot program we've been running in Africa called Dairy Nourishes Africa, that in a very short time period, you can have a major impact on GHG emissions. We know we can do it. So in 5 years' time, apart from looking for the wheelchair access and maybe where the nearest bathroom is, I'd love to think that we're talking about the results that are coming from the Pathways to Dairy Net Zero, and not just those 10 early adopters, but the whole idea behind them is to create a movement, a global movement for the dairy sector. So I'm very positive about what we can do in 5, 10 years' time.
Love your answer.
Yeah, and actually, I would say the same. I'm an optimistic, so I do see that positive ahead of us. But maybe one thing I'd like to add is maybe because in 5 years, then it will be almost the close to the 2030 for the agenda in terms of sustainable development goals. So the one thing I want to see is a bit more of integration of the contribution of dairy in the national reporting, because I think that for government, it's an opportunity, because dairy is strongly delivering on many SDGs. And that could be used easily by governments to showcase their progress. And I'd like to see a bit more of that. So that would be my wish for the next 5 years.
Great question. You know, one thing we communicated pretty strongly with the farmers when we first came out with these goals is that this is a journey. This is not something that we're speeding to. We're going to get to in 2, 3, 4, 5 years. It is a journey. And each year we'll do something, we'll make improvements. But I feel like as long as we are making improvements, we're making headway. Now, yes, the improvements can't come fast enough. And I feel like agriculture and dairy needs to have the respect that it deserves for the nutrition that it packs. But it's important for us to realize that this is a journey and we're taking steps.
Excellent. Cecilia, can I modify this a little bit for you? In 5 years, do you see your neighbors in the region being closer to where you are today? You're the leader in your region, no doubt. Do you see that influence? So, putting the minister on the spot a little bit.
He's the Minister of Agriculture of my country. So, yes, why not? Yeah, I'm optimistic.
Good answer.
We are stewards. We're working here for future generations. And that applies for me as a person, as a family, as a citizen, as a world citizen. So there's no other answer than that. There cannot be any other answer than saying yes, the same as what you said. Yeah.
So progress. Progress, yes. In 5 years. Measurable progress. We'll have a fun reunion. I'm going to call you back now in 5 years, wherever we are. Well, thank you to our panelists. They've been wonderful. I love the discussion, the dialogue that we were hoping for, not just a Q&A, but more building off each other's answers. So much is going on in dairy. I hope the rest of the world, rest of agriculture, the rest of the consuming public recognizes the commitments, the contributions of dairy, not only in nutrition, but also to the environment. We are an environmental solution. So thank you to the audience and appreciate y'all being here. In a picture?
Yes.
Picture of the panelists.
Come on, boss, we need to be in the middle.
Yes, I do.